This is a gentle reminder that church is beginning in 54 seconds. So try to end your conversations with your neighbors and let's attitude into a thought of prayer and worship as we get ready. Thank you. Good morning and welcome. It's great to see so many in our congregation today, whether you're here with us in person or joining us on Facebook or live streaming. We are glad you're here with us on this last Sunday in June. Please join me now in our contemporary call to worship, which is inspired by Mark 5, 21 to 43. With friends and strangers and family, with family and neighbors, we gather.
Come among us, healing God, with that love which never ends.
With faith reaching out to touch, with hearts straining to trust, we hope.
Come among us, strength of the broken, with your compassion which makes us whole.
With word and wonder, with silence and song, we wait.
Come among us, prior of our tears, to lift us to our feet of all unity.
Good morning. And good morning to all of you children at home. Now, does anybody have a pair of these at home? Some of you may be wearing them today. Yeah, I saw some hands back there, and I'm sure you at home know what these are. These are flip-flops. And what a wonderful thing to put on after a long winter are these in the summertime. It just makes you feel light and airy, and as soon as it gets warm enough, this is what's on my feet until it gets too cold to wear them. There's a lot of good things about flip-flops, but there are kind of some bad things, too. Now, when you've had these on all day long and you've been out doing whatever it is you've been doing that day, are your feet very clean when you come in? No. They're usually really dirty, and I'm sure some of you, they're probably even a little stinky. Yeah. Yeah. Now, back in Jesus' time, they didn't have shoes or socks to keep their feet clean and dry and less stinky. Everybody wore sandals. If you could afford to have any kind of shoe on, it was a sandal. Some people couldn't even afford those, and they went barefoot all the time. So you think about what your feet would look like wearing these day in and day out. They'd get pretty gross, wouldn't they? Yeah. And a tradition started to wear, back in Jesus' time, if you ever got invited to someone's house, a servant would wash your feet when you came into the house. Now, do you think many servants were going, I want to wash the feet, I want to wash the feet? No. It was probably one of the dirtiest and yuckiest jobs you could have had as a servant back in the times of Jesus, was washing everybody's stinky, dirty feet. And that meant everybody. So some days you might wash 5 people's feet. If there was a big party at the house or they were entertaining or having friends over for dinner, you might wash 50 feet or 100 feet. Stinky, dirty feet. So when Jesus washed the feet of his disciples, that was a huge deal. Because I don't think your school principals or your friends, probably even the president, wouldn't get down on his hands and knees and wash your feet. But Jesus did. Now, this was the man whose his disciples followed. They gave up everything to follow him. They believed that he was the King of Kings, the Messiah. But he got down on his knees and he washed their stinky, dirty feet. The most yucky job in the whole wide world. Our Lord and Savior got down on his hands and knees and washed their feet. He would wash my feet. He would wash your feet. So it's hard to imagine us not having a servant's heart like that. If Jesus was willing to get down on his hands and knees and wash the feet of his disciples, we should be willing to serve others like that. Our friends, our neighbors, even our enemies. Let's have a word of prayer. Dear Jesus, please help us to have a servant's heart. Please help us to serve and love each other the way you love us. Amen.
I just have a quick announcement to make. First of all, I love seeing all your beautiful faces. You don't have a mask on, and I love it. Anyways, so the youth has decided to take part in a 5K on Saturday, July 17th for the Trevor Project. The Trevor Project is the world's largest suicide prevention and crisis intervention organization for the LGBTQ community. As a youth, we're aware of the increasing mental health issues among our generation. It's worrying as we watch our peers struggle with depression and anxiety, and these issues are more in the LGBT community. So we would love if you all would join us on the 17th of July at 9 a.m. at Joplin and help us donate to the Trevor Project. Thank you.
Go from the pretty to the ugly. That's a hard act to follow. Hello, I'm Mike Warwick, and it's my honor to be the delegate for annual conference. This year, annual conference was a little bit different. Last year, it was different also. Last year, we assembled at various churches. We went, Paul and myself and Dave Biondi went to Cross Lanes United Methodist Church for a virtual conference. It really wasn't a conference. It was just essentially renewing everything that was in place from the year before. Because of the pandemic, there was not much of an agenda except to just extend the policies and procedures that were in place previously. This year was a little bit different. They did have a limited number of folks that were able to attend at Wesleyan. The rest of us were online, and you obtained your voting credentials and worked your way through the process, things that, to ensure that only people that should have been voting on issues were actually voting. But anyway, this year was a little bit different too. Annual conference consisted of several different events. There was a laity session in May that I know that I watched, and I'm sure several others in the church did. One thing that I learned then was that our bishop is. Sandra Steiner Ball is not only the bishop of the West Virginia Conference, but her and another lady are bishops over three conferences. So we're sort of sharing her with a couple other annual conferences from Pennsylvania, but we also have the benefit of a second bishop that the West Virginia Conference is part of her responsibilities. So anyway, the laity session was interesting, and there was this on Thursday, June 3rd, was opening worship, and among the things that occurred during the opening worship service was recognizing the pastors or spouses that had passed away. And this particular year, there were two that I was familiar with. One was Bonnie Eskew, and the second was David Bird's mother. And so it was for the past 2 years, because they didn't have this last year. But that was very meaningful service, and I was thankful to participate in that. On Saturday, June 5th, that was the business session. There was nothing controversial or nothing. There was some debate. Some people, myself probably included in that, just like to hear themselves talk. So there was some debate and some amendments, but there's a new insurance plan that is being offered for the pastors with increased options and also dental and vision. It's intended to standardize the insurance options across the across the conference. Additionally, there was a discussion about compensation. There's three different categories of ministers, and the way that the conference works is that ministers in certain charges or certain churches are required to have minimum salary. So there was a modest $800 per year increase that was approved for minimum starting salaries for pastors in the three categories. There's also the conference budget was voted on and approved, and it was for 5% less than what the annual budget was this year. So I think that's a good thing. We can all be assured that the finance committee and those involved with the conference finances are mindful of the situation that we're in and are trying to keep costs low. One of the things, the last thing I want to touch on was there was previously a covenant council, and that's a group of individuals that sort of set policy within the Methodist Church. Certain activities are required by the Book of Discipline to occur, but then this creation of a core leadership team was approved, and that replaces the Covenant Council. And this is a group of 12 to 18 people conference-wide that will be responsible for assisting churches in various activities. Again, certain things are required by the Book of Discipline, but this core leadership team has a lot of flexibility to allow churches to request special assistance in different needs that they may have. I'll conclude with that by saying that there's information if anybody's interested. All the sessions of the conference were videotaped, and they're available on the West Virginia UMC, WVUMC website. And anybody's interested in viewing those or seeing what happened, there's a summary sheet for what happened at conference. It's a good resource. If anybody has any questions or concerns that they want to bring to me, I'll be happy to meet and discuss any issue with anybody. I'm honored to be the conference representative from First United Methodist Church. Thank you.
I am reading today 2 Corinthians 12, 2 through 10. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. Was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast. And on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. If I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me. Even considering the exceptional character of the revelations, therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. I'm also reading from Mark chapter 6, 1 through 13. He left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James and Joses and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony among them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
As we enter into our joys and concerns, I'd like to share with you the names of those that are on our prayer request list for this week. The family of David Lawrence, who passed away Sunday, June 20th. Also, the Reverend Nancy White, Barbara Ratliff, Bill Spence, Derek, Cindy, and Gus Biondi, Barbara Lockhart, Sam Femia, Jody Polly, Michelle Oldaker, Bill Jeanette, Connie Rollins, Eric Lips, Patty Helmick, Cheryl Krieger Morgan, David Moore, and Nancy Friedlander.
Let us pray. O Lord, you are indeed the healer of all ills. We bring to you, Lord, our bodies, minds, and spirits, hurting and broken by the violence, ills, trauma, and cares of a world separated from you. Come to us now with your healing powers. O God, we ask that you heal us. Give us the strength, health, wisdom, and knowledge found only through you. Send your life-giving spirit so that we may live our lives with courage in the profound peace of your love. Come to us now with your healing powers. Breathe on me, O God, and make me whole. O God, we ask that you sustain those who seek to alleviate the pain and suffering of this world. Give strength, courage, wisdom, and knowledge to all doctors and orderlies, nurses and clerks, psychiatrists, researchers, and all other medical caregivers, volunteers, and professionals. Send us your life-giving spirit so that their ministries may bring healing and promote health. Come to us now with your healing powers. Be also with those who work to heal the wounds of societies and nations. Guide, protect, and strengthen our lawyers and police, chaplains and pastors, healthcare and social workers, politicians, military, diplomats, and all others who work for economic and social reform. Send your life-giving spirit that they may promote your love and grace, bringing healing to those in conflict and stability to those who are vulnerable. Come to us now with your healing powers. Breathe on me, O God, and make me whole. God so loved this world and his people that God sent Christ to suffer and die for us. Accept now that gift. Know that you are forgiven, reconciled, accepted, and loved. And now, as children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
my appreciation to Mike for his report from annual conference. And even though it wasn't the way we've always done things, we got along fairly well and business moved pretty quickly. And many of us that have sat through hours upon hours of endless debate in the chapel at West Virginia Wesleyan College, we're grateful that things online seem to move faster. So we were appreciative of that. I also appreciate Ella bringing you some information from our youth group, who continue to meet throughout the summer periodically from time to time and are looking at various social issues that involve them and the community around us and taking a stand and wanting to be an active part of some of the solutions, not just the problems. So you'll get some more information about the project that the youth group is working on right now and how you can be supportive of that. But I think it's excellent that they from time to time pick projects outside of our church range of things to make contributions to and to have their voices heard. Now, I want to read one extra piece of scripture this morning. Again, from 2 Corinthians. The 8th chapter, starting with the 7th verse through the 15th. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. I am not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And here is my judgment about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have desire to do so. Now finish the work so that your eager willingness to do may be matched by your completion of it, according to all of your means. For it is the willingness, if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but they might be equality. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. The goal is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. This is the word of God through Paul to the people of God. There's a story about C.S. Lewis. C.S. Lewis is the author of Narnia and The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. He's also a truly remarkable theologian, pastor, and professor of his time. But it talks about that one day he walked in the middle of an academic discussion about the distinctiveness of Christianity. Those that were present were about to decide that there was nothing that set Christianity apart from any of the other world religions because they were unable to come up with anything that truly marked our faith and set it apart from the rest. So they put the question to Lewis. He paused only a moment and said, "That's easy. It's grace." Grace is what makes us who we are as followers of Jesus Christ. Grace is one of the fundamental principles of the United Methodist Church. Grace is what motivates us to respond with love, joy, and hope. Grace is what equips us for living in this world and what allows us to create a sense of community as we seek out other recipients of God's grace. It is what we have to offer the world, nothing of our own, but the gifts that come from grace. That is what Paul is saying in his writings, in maybe a convoluted or a hidden way, in the text that I read you from 2 Corinthians. This is part of Paul's stewardship campaign sermon. And it's never too early to speak about stewardship, and it's never too often to speak about stewardship. And like all of us, he talks all around it in such a way that you just might miss what he's saying. Paul is taking a collection for the church in Jerusalem. You see, the growth was out in the suburbs, and the downtown church was suffering. Not exactly what was going on, but sort of, and maybe even something you can relate to in situations of our cities in West Virginia and the growth of the rural areas. So Paul went from church to church asking for mission giving, and the churches responded. Reading the first part of chapter 8, you'll note that Paul is very proud of them giving. Some of them gave, even though they also had struggles of their own. And now he comes back to Corinth, a church that he has struggled with, to be fair, a church with a few problems and some dissension. All of our pastors have their own Corinth somewhere in their careers. But he still invites people to give. He invites them to participate. Now you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in your love for you. So we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. Now, that sounds like a very classical way of buttering people up before you ask them for something. You flatter them a little bit before you hand them the bill. But that isn't what he does. The last two words of verse 7 here are translated as generous undertaking. He wants them to excel, to participate, to enjoy this generous undertaking. Throughout my career, it has always amazed me as how people have said, while they struggled early on, they finally came to the contention that tithing was really a responsibility, and the more they were able to work towards the tithe and become the tithe, the easier it was for them to do many other things. The generosity they had in giving filled up many of the holes that was in their heart before, and they started looking at life in a different way. He wants them to excel, to participate. The Greek words here are charis parousia, which probably better translates abounding grace. The invitation is not to give, but to participate in grace, an abounding grace. Paul goes on to explain that this is what Jesus did for us by emptying himself, giving up and giving away what we might know as glory, that we might then know hope and salvation, that we might be able to give away grace because we had received it. Paul is trying to tell the Corinthians that he is doing them a favor by letting them give. He knows that they, like we, want to know the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, I know the grace. Not only can you know it, but you can live it. Not only can you receive it as a gift, but you can also activate it by giving it away, by participating in the ripples of grace that go from person to person, community to community, and bring transformation and an experience of the kingdom. He concludes the invitation by reminding us that love needs proof from time to time. Love needs action to really be love, at least the love that Christ calls us to do, the love that God expresses. And the most famous verse of all the New Testament reminds us that for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever shall believe in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. That's probably one of the very first scriptures we teach our little ones in memories. Unless you have a slow learner like me, and they started me on the very short verse of Jesus wept. In the gospel text from Mark, it is Jesus who is the example of grace, or the example of giving what he has. Jesus takes the opportunity to seize the moment. He responds to the need and is fully present with those who come to him, even though this is an interruption in the middle of everything we do. Many times we get those interruptions, and I remember surprising one of my professors in a class I was taking on time management. And he said, "How do you fill up your day?" And I said, "I have at least four spots during the day that I just schedule for planned interruptions, because they're going to happen. And I just give myself a little extra time during the day that I can catch everything else up." So sometimes I wonder if Jesus got exasperated at interruptions. It seems that time and time again, someone was running up to him to change the situation and their course in life. And I know that Jesus is ready to help and to heal and to go where he is needed the most. But still, the demands of a crowd wanting something from him must have been, well, like barking dogs getting on your last nerve. I can relate to that. I've been in a few places where the next door neighbor's dog chooses 3 a.m. to get the loudest. But if you read the Gospels, you can't see Jesus being shaken. It seems to be that he has an infinite amount of patience that he can draw on. Well, there was that one time he got a little short with some folks, but that's another story for another day. For the most part, Jesus was grace incarnate. Well, I suppose, of course, that is the point. Not only him, but we are as well. And that's the hard part that we have to deal with. It's not to see more needs, people, or opportunities as interruptions, but as grace moments to give and to receive, to be attentive and to be present, to be alive and real, just like Jesus was and like Jesus is. We need to learn the art of to be present and alive. There is more here, however, than just the interruption. There's healing that goes along with it. There's an acceptance. There's a life out of death. There is hope. There's a story of a 12-year spiral of a girl leading to rock bottom and her young life simply vanishing like the morning mist. There is a daughter that is reclaimed from shame and suffering, and there is a daughter that is reclaimed from death at the action of Jesus. There is wonder. There is laughter. Both before and after Jesus has come into the picture. And there is a secret. Yes, there's a secret that's mentioned. Why does Jesus tell them not to tell when they aren't going to help but tell? When do you undo a funeral and not have someone who's going to ask a few questions? Now, it seems like a very odd thing for Jesus to do. Surely he knew that everyone was going to tell someone. unless the commandment wasn't not to tell, but to say who got to do the telling. The only ones in the room were the little girl's parents and three disciples. Maybe he wanted the story to be hers and not theirs. Maybe Jesus was setting the precedent for witness of telling your own story and not someone else's. Every one of us has a Jesus story that is where we made a commitment to follow Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. But too many times we keep that to ourselves and figure that we've given a silent witness just by the fact we come to church. But we need to tell it with our living, and we need to tell it with our words, and we need to be willing to testify, as old-time churchgoers tell us. There needs to be opportunities for the common layperson to say, I accepted Jesus Christ at this point in my life, and it's made a change. And sometimes it's early in life, sometimes it's as a child, sometimes it's as an adult, sometimes it's in the middle of a crisis. Remember Jesus' first words to the parents was, give her something to eat. And many times we need to give those in front of us something to eat, both literally and physically. Jairus is the leader of the synagogue, Mark tells us. That gives him some stature, and that puts a certain aura around him. Jairus is the person that others go to. He's a decider, a determiner. He has resources. He has the position. He has power. He is used, I am quite sure, to solve many of his own problems, except for this one. My little daughter, he says, is 12 years old, almost an adult, a marriageable age. Not anymore, Ella. Ready to move out and to move on. But at the point of death, she becomes his little daughter all again. Lay your hands on her, he asks. Bless her, ordain her, set her apart, heal her. This is what he's asking of Jesus. Save her. The word in translation here is sozos. Sometimes it's translated as heal. Sometimes it's translated as save, as in you are saved. Save her. He asked that, and so she may be made well and alive. Not just made well, but to live as well. He asked that Jesus bless her with the fullness of life and give her all that is in store for her, the potential, the goodness, the glory of God. Let her shine, he asked. No, it's more than asking. He's begging. He's on his knees. He's face down in the dust. He's clinging to Jesus' ankles, and he's begging. That's a follower. He hadn't been a follower before, as far as we know. But he is now. Because he interrupted the interruptible Jesus, and he pleaded for help. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we come to you because we can't do this alone. We need help. We need your help. Lay your hands on us. Bless them. Bless us. Bless all that we encounter. Use our hands. Use our knees. Use whatever it takes to save us, to make us well and alive. Then we can learn to give what we have received. grace upon grace. In your holy and powerful name we pray. Amen. Things are beginning to change around here. We're getting ready to get back into the full swing of things. School starts a little earlier this year than usual. We're looking at August as beginning to get back into our WOW program and to have things in place for our Sunday school program. And though we have some people who help with our Sunday school week after week, we could use some more. In fact, it would be good if we had enough teachers that you only needed to teach once a month, and you could pick the Sunday, and we could get you the information, and you could come well prepared with your lesson and your snack, and have an eager bunch of children ready to hear. We're looking for a few more people to help with that. We're looking for a few people who know how to turn on a computer, and we would be willing to train you how to do a few more things with that computer. So if you're in one of those moods to volunteer or looking for a way that you can serve the church in a more useful capacity, we would love to have you as a volunteer. There's no limit on age, no limit on abilities, because God will provide you the graces that you need to do the job that you are set about to do. And for that, we are very excited. You'll notice a few things being house cleaned or spring cleaned. We're in the middle of a couple of projects to paint a few rooms and things like that. You've probably noticed the update to the sign in the front of the church. It got a fresh coat of paint around the cross and flame. Same with our events sign down there. We're hoping to get the community to actively read those things as they go by every day. So we're putting up various things to catch their attention from time to time. So we continue to give you thanks for the fact that you are supporting us, even in the days that we were not face-to-face, that we were strictly online, and of course we're still online because many of our folks today who you normally see in the pew might be out at the lake or in the mountains or in another state or at the beach or just got a late start on the day and are drinking a cup of coffee in front of their computer screen right now. But we're glad they're with us, because the Spirit of God extends well beyond the walls of this church. And in the lives that you live and in the actions that you take every day, you have an opportunity to witness, and we give thanks for that. And one of the ways that you witness very faithfully is in your tithes, contributions, and offerings to First United Methodist Church. So let us give thanks for that as we for a blessing on the offerings that come to us. God of boundless generosity, as we offer our gifts and our lives to you, help us to hear and heed your Apostle Paul. We long to grow as disciples, so that we grow in generosity. The abundance we've been given has a purpose in your plan, that we might know the joy of sharing that abundance with those who are in need. We long for that vision of your kingdom, where loving hearts bring better balance between abundance and need. In the name of Christ, our teacher and redeemer, we pray. Amen. Let us join together now in our closing hymn. Go out among the outcast and the grieving, and speak the word of life and hope. Do not fear, but trust in God's word. Watch for the Lord with eager expectation, and be generous with all God has given you. And may God respond to your every cry with mercy. May Christ Jesus take you by the hand and lift you to life. And may the Holy Spirit build you up in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in passion, and in love. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.